from his friends, Aidan. I mentioned when I spoke earlier about Desi's role in developing the radical revolutionary political base that is now the Workers' Party, that Desi had undergone a change, his own transition away from the narrow straits of nationalism. But he also recognised that Northern Ireland was not a democratic society. Northern Ireland had not been founded on democratic principles, it had not been constructed along democratic principles, and there was a fundamental and basic inequality that existed at the core of the state. And he recognised that in trying to build the one thing that would challenge that and would challenge the hegemony of the Irish nationalist right in all of Ireland was working class unity. But this was no mere idle dream that he had. He knew that it had to be worked hard at. And he knew in particular in Northern Ireland that these basic inequalities also had to be addressed. And that on the basis of the ethnic differences that were constructed within Northern Ireland, these constructed rivalries of Irishness and Britishness, that it was necessary to challenge the fundamental inequality on which the Northern Ireland state was founded, and the hegemony of the right-wing Unionist Party. He recognised, along with others, and was a founding member of the Northern Ireland Civil Rights Association. And for Desi, civil rights was no idle abstract, something that he had learned in prison or in the, you know, from the protests of Martin Luther King's civil rights movement in America. He realised that it had a fundamental role to play in constructing working class unity in Northern Ireland, to remove these constructed artificial divisions between Irish Catholic and Irish Protestant workers. And that's what civil rights meant to Desi. And Desi recognised that there was a real need for that hegemony of unionism to be challenged in Northern Ireland. And on the basis of that would follow working class unity. He recognised also, of course, that there were very real sectarian divisions within Northern Ireland. And that these sectarian divisions didn't rest simply on one side. There were different parties, different groups, who had a vested interest in the continuance of that sectarianism, both on the Catholic and on the so-called Protestant and Catholic divide, etc. So for Desi, civil rights was an instrument in the role of the wider struggle to construct a unity amongst working people. And that the revolution that he sought to achieve could not be possible without that unity. And civil rights to Desi, and for the others who were involved in it at that particular time, was a recognition that fundamental democratic liberties had to be achieved in Northern Ireland, and that class politics would flow from that. Unfortunately, there are other elements, both in what we call the Unionist and Irish Nationalist side, that worked tirelessly to undermine that unity that was briefly achieved under civil rights. It's often forgotten that, largely I believe, at Desi's behest, that one of the founding members of the Northern Ireland Civil Rights, the actual executive that met in Belfast, was also a member of the Unionist Party, member of the Young Unionist Association. And in the early days, that's what civil rights represented. And indeed, Desi was one of the people who was instrumental in ensuring that the title of the Civil Rights Association would not be the Northern Civil Rights Association or the North East Ulster Civil Rights Association. It was the Northern Ireland Civil Rights Association, because it was designed to attract the broadest possible popular base, a base that transcended the religious and sectarian differences that existed at that particular time. So when Desi was involved in civil rights, as I said, it was not a mere abstract idea that Desi was pursuing. He was pursuing an integral part of the project of achieving class unity. And I certainly was always influenced by what Desi said in respect of that. And we have had some glimpses of what Desi said in the past about different aspects of Northern Ireland's politics. But one thing's for sure that he remained committed to from day one until the very end was this working class unity. And his role in civil rights was deliberately and consciously designed to further that class unity. Thank you.
Comrades, Desi O'Hagan was fearless. A fearless thinker, a fearless political activist, a fearless innovator who focused relentlessly on one single question. What are the best means of advancing the interests of the working class in Ireland and throughout the world? Desi was a revolutionary who knew his history, but he refused to be hidebound by it. Instead, he consistently sought to develop the core principles of the revolutionary tradition to meet contemporary conditions. As he stated in an important speech in defence of the party in 1992, and which is available here today, the transition from the Republican movement to the Workers' Party was not done by going outside our tradition. It was achieved by developing the tradition to meet our needs. And he would sometimes put that more succinctly by saying, I'm a Republican in the French tradition, I believe in the guillotine. In other words, comrades, while it is essential to act according to our fundamental principles and to be respectful of our past, we must ensure that our party and our efforts address the world of today and that we focus on building a workers' party capable of shaping a better tomorrow. With that in mind, I want to talk about what I personally learned from Desi's theory and from his praxis. I want to talk about how some examples of how Desi applied the core principles of the Irish and international revolutionary tradition to the modern world, and Desi was an internationalist to his fingertips, and what we must do to take forward Desi's vision of building a party of and for the working class, capable of constructing a democratic, secular, socialist, unitary state on the island of Ireland, a republic. I first met Desi O'Hagan in 1994 in Cypress Street when I was 16 years of age, and I can honestly say my life was never the same again. At that time, I was rethinking my own politics. I had come out the other side of a phase of supporting extreme nationalism and was reading a bit of Conley, bit of Marx, bit of Lenin, and some other left-wing authors, especially about history and imperialism. I had even read some Trotsky. Not that I ever admitted that to Desi, a man who kept a woodcut of Stalin made in Lancash amongst his prized possessions. He was always that little bit too scary to ever admit that to him. Raised in a house of strong anti-sectarian values myself, I saw only one party that stood clearly for anti-sectarian socialist politics, and I began to seek out and read material from the Workers' Party. Before meeting Desi then, I had independently come to the conclusion that the Workers' Party had the right programme, although this was rooted more in its opposition to sectarianism than any developed understanding of the precise form of socialism that the party espoused. Over the next few years, I was lucky enough to meet Desi regularly, both to practice my Irish and to discuss history, Marxist theory, and politics in Northern Ireland. No offence, Tom. I am who I am, and I can honestly say this, I am who I am because of those conversations with Desi O'Hagan. My politics were shaped by these discussions about the fundamentals of Marxism, about past and contemporary events, about Desi's experience of the strengths and weaknesses of the socialist states in Eastern Europe, and about the nature of politics and society in Ireland and further afield. I was struck by Desi's passionate, indeed his virulent, opposition to sectarianism. His contempt for nationalism of any kind, anywhere, and by his absolute conviction that socialists in Ireland could never, ever compromise on the secularist agenda, especially in light of what had happened to the communists in Algeria and in Iran at the hands of religiously inspired nationalists. I was also struck by Desi's absolute belief that no matter how long or how arduous the struggle the future was socialism. I'm sure that these conversations were very basic to Desi, and they certainly were when it came to the Irish conversations. But one of Desi's great strengths was to take people as he found them, to connect with them on a human level, and to talk to them about politics in a way that they could understand. And this is what made Desi the perfect choice for the party's National Education Officer. I'll never forget, for example, Desi talking to a group from the Workers' Party Youth in Belfast about the education system there. He explained how it was built in the interest of the middle classes, not just through the obvious means of the 11 plus, but also through the fact that the teachers drove into working class areas to do their job and then retreated as quickly as possible to the middle class communities where they lived. And that their lives bore little relation to those of the children they were supposed to educate and towards whom they often felt little sympathy. It was, comrades, a simple but devastating critique of an education system specifically designed to reinforce and reproduce class power, delivered with clarity and with passion, and one that rang true with the young members and gave focus to something that they instinctively felt as a response to their own experiences. As we saw on the video package, Desi had a rare talent for communication and for education. And it is no accident that he spent so much of his work in the party educating its members, young and old. He knew young people and new blood were the future of the party and of the struggle for socialism. Over the 6 years following my first meeting with Desi, as a schoolboy and then a student, I had a lot of time and I spent quite a lot of it in the Belfast office, not to mention, it has to be said, the Oak and Cypress Street, with Desi and John Laurie and Ailish Duffy and Brendy Burns, watching and learning as they did everything from advice work, to publishing the Northern People, to coordinating party activities across the North. During that time, Desi never ceased to educate, debate with, and challenge me, sharpening my own critical faculties and helping me understand how Marxism-Leninism functioned as a tool for the creative analysis of society and for political engagement with the right here, right now, and not simply a set of unchanging dogmas and strategies to be slavishly repeated without regard to changing circumstances. As he liked to put it himself, there are no winter palaces to be stormed in modern Western Europe. How are we going to build socialism in that context? 1996 was the year that I got my party card, and the Northern Ireland Regional Conference that year showed exactly how the party used Marxism dynamically, and how, while understanding the importance of the past, the party was never constricted by it. Desi took great satisfaction putting his favourite quote from Marx on the front cover, and it was a quote that Aidan referred to at Desi's funeral. It is not the consciousness of men that determine their existence, but their social existence that determine their consciousness. This is an assertion of the very core of Marxism, of materialism as the basis for understanding the human condition. In standing on its head, the Hegelian belief that reality was formed of ideas incarnate, in realizing that the dominant ideas of any given time reflected economic reality and class power, Marx and Engels were able to identify the working class as the agent of liberation for all humanity, and to develop scientific socialism based on the actual reality in societies shaped by class struggle. It was the application of this core principle to contemporary Irish society that allowed Republicans to break out of narrow militaristic nationalism and to build the Workers' Party, a process which, as we've already heard, Desi played a major role in. As Desi himself noted in his contribution to the 1996 conference, understanding the nature of consciousness and social existence, understanding the relationship between class interest and politics, meant stressing the common interest of workers of all religions and none. It meant trying to raise class consciousness and trying to strip away the false consciousness created by sectarianism and the all-class alliances of unionism and nationalism, which served only the interests of the bourgeoisie at home and abroad. Thus, Desi, on behalf of the party, used the fundamental principles of Marxism to shape our analysis and our strategy in the contemporary world. John Lowry's speech on that occasion, which was entitled 1996 is not 1969, did the same thing. In that speech, John outlined how things have fundamentally changed since 1969, and how the refusal to understand and to acknowledge that had fed the anti-working class terrorism that took so many lives, that further divided the working class, that wasted decades, and that squeezed the space for progressive politics. John's speech, like Desi's, looked to the future, and the role of the party in raising class consciousness to shape a different and a better future. While the party was focused firmly on its future, that year also saw a small group try to turn the clock back to the 1970s. To reverse the progress made in placing Ireland once more in the mainstream of the international revolutionary tradition, with a transformation of the Republican movement into a Marxist party based on Leninist principles of organisation. As he had done in 1992, Desi stood firmly and unambiguously for the ideological and organisational principles of the Workers' Party, and of the need to focus on the future and not the past. As with the Provisionals, the IRSP and the DLs before them, Desi became an object of vituperation and vitriol for these people because of his loyalty to and defence of genuine class politics. Raising class consciousness was at the core of Desi's very existence, and it dictated his every action, whether as party education officer, the editor of party publications, the author of party pamphlets, set piece speeches, or statements, as a candidate, as an activist, and in his everyday life. Now, sometimes, as we all know, it has to be said that this went better than others. During the 1997 election campaign, when the party leaflets designed by Desi had for the unity of Protestant, Catholic, and dissenter emblazoned on the back, he had a long talk about the importance of anti-sectarianism and class politics with some bin men in what would usually be described as a loyalist area. He seemed to have made some progress. The bin lorry drove 100 yards up the road, stopped, the cab door opened, one of the bin men emerged and shouted, "Up the UVF." We can only assume that in this particular case, he hadn't quite succeeded. However, Desi had plenty of successes, and there were people who swapped both violent nationalism and violent unionism for socialism because of their discussions with Desi. Desi saved people's lives with these discussions. We've heard today about Desi's importance in the role of building the Workers' Party and in defeating the liquidators of 1992. He immediately then looked to the future. In 1993, he published The Future is Socialism, which provided a Marxist analysis of the rise of neoliberalism, of the counter-revolutions that had recently taken place in Eastern Europe, of the consequent flight from socialism at home and abroad, of the rise of what soon would be called Blairism, and of conditions in Ireland at that time, North and South, and of the tasks the party faced as it sought to rebuild in an era when the triumphant capitalists had decreed the end of history. The very title of that pamphlet, The Future is Socialism, was a defiant retort to Fukuyama and his acolytes, and it confronted what Desi rightly called the sense of despair amongst many in the communist and workers' movement at home and abroad. It was a work, I feel, of the greatest theoretical significance. It demonstrated the continuing importance and relevance of Marxism-Leninism in the post-Soviet world, and its continuing ability to strip away the veil beneath which the naked class power of the bourgeoisie was hidden. There's no time here to go into this work in detail, but some of the subheadings give a flavour of its themes and arguments. The necessity of history, international working class unity, winning jobs, right to work, the centrality of ownership, nature of capitalism, the failure of sectarian politics, a central role for the state, improving the quality of life, fundamental requirement, revolutionary understanding, challenge for socialists, And the most important question of all, what of the future? To me at least, this was Desi's finest work, not just for the quality and the accuracy of its analysis, but for the timing of it. It was the application of a Marxist analysis at its best when it was needed most. It seems to me that this pamphlet was even more important than his 1975 work, The Republican Tradition, which also provided ideological clarity to our party at a crucial time in its history. As with the concept of republicanism from 1998, which has been referred to already and is available today, the futurist socialism demonstrated the mixture of fundamentals and innovation that made Desi such a dynamic Marxist thinker. In my view, the most important Ireland has produced since Connolly. What then must we do to take forward the vision to which Desi dedicated his life? We must take inspiration from the theory and the praxis, not just of Desi, but of that whole generation that built the Workers' Party, people like Sean and Cahill and Tomás and Billy McMillan. They questioned everything. They were not afraid to innovate, but they stayed true to their core principles and to their roots in a changing world. And this is what we must do. And I would urge everyone to read The Flight from Socialism, where Tomás McGilla talks about the need for the party of the working class to live and breathe and adapt as conditions adapt, but stay true to its own principles. In the 2010 and 2014 Ardeshina, we, to use Desi's words from 1993, correctly said about the serious business of theoretical renewal. And serious, I suspect, was a word that Mrs. O'Hagan used, because I heard Raymond talk about the same thing when he spoke about politics. We have deepened this serious work. We have deepened the work of internal education to help build a class-conscious membership, equipped to analyse the world around them. We have deepened our analysis and our publications and our propaganda. And this work must continue to be strengthened, particularly on vital areas such as eco-socialism and the increasing precariousness of employment, of which we've had an extremely graphic and vicious, to use another favourite word of Desi's, example today with the Cleary's workers. Again, to quote Desi, this time at the grave of our murdered comrade, Paul Crawford, who was selling the United Irishman when he was shot in April 1975, education of ourselves and others is one of the most important dimensions of revolutionary activity. We must improve, we must develop, we must expand our range of party publications, both in print and online. Desi understood the value of publications and of keeping up with modern technology, even if Quark often saw him call for the return of the typewriter. But he also understood that one of the most vital things about publications was that they provided an opportunity to talk to people one-to-one, to build relationships and to get the socialist message across in a message that people can understand and thus to mobilise them. Desi was an educator, he was an agitator, he was also an organiser. He knew the importance of the principles by which we organised the party and of democratic centralism. He knew the need to recruit amongst the most class-conscious elements of society, whether that was in schools, in workplaces, in universities, in trade unions, wherever such people can be found. He also grasped the necessity for finance, for fundraising, for creating the conditions for a strong and functioning party centre, capable of giving direction to the party, capable of supporting the activities of the branches in the regions, and capable of building the party's influence amongst the working class and in public life. To continue Desi's works, therefore, comrades, we need to go from here today and build that strong workers' party, a party with a class-conscious membership, active in the people's organisations and in communities, a party capable of effecting revolutionary change in our society, of defeating sectarianism, of defeating capitalism, and of building a truly democratic and egalitarian society on our island. That, comrades, is how Desi O'Hagan would recognise someone determined to follow in his footsteps. Thank you, comrades.
Mighty Spartans, from your slumbers arise, ye criminals of war. For reason in revolt now clamors, and at last ends the age of cant. Now away with all your superstitions, say my masses arise. We'll end what with the old conditions and serve the dust to win the prize. So comrades, come rally, and the last fight let us face the international unites the human race. So comrades, come rally, and the last fight let us face the international unites the human race. No savior from on high deliver, no trust have we in Prince of Peace. Our old right hand, the chain of silver, chains of hatred, greed, and fear. On our flesh, till love has fed the raven, till long we've been the vulture's prey. But farewell now, the spirit craven, the dawn brings in a bright new day. So comrades, come rally, and the last fight let us face the international unites the human race. So comrades, come rally, and the last fight let us face the international unites the human race. We peasants, artisans, and dabblers enrolled among the sons of toil, we claim henceforth the world as brothers, drive the endolent from the soil. Fed the raven, to long we feed the vulture's prey. But fair